Erik Schlenker-Goodrich, thank you for joining us from the Western Environmental Law Center. For more than 3 years now, we've watched the Trump administration roll back environmental laws. But with attention on COVID-19, we've seen some pretty big changes in quick succession just over like the past 4 or 5 weeks. Can you talk about what you think are some of the most major policy changes or moves on the Trump administration's part?
Yes, absolutely. Thank you, Laura. You know, one thing that I'd emphasize as an initial matter is that this comes with a backdrop of the Trump administration being ideologically hostile to environmental safeguards as a first order matter. And part of the reason for that is the Trump administration views this as a way to prop up its base and to get its base motivated in terms of engaging on issues and effectively supporting the administration itself. So now with the coronavirus outbreak, all of this is accelerated. You know, at one level, you would think that things would slow down in terms of environmental rollbacks. We are not seeing this. And in part, this is a product of the fact that the coronavirus outbreak is occurring at the same time that there's an oil price war underway globally. And that is causing a bloodbath in oil and gas production fields that are particularly important here in New Mexico in both the San Juan and the Permian basins. So the oil and gas industry has ramped up its efforts to lobby the Trump administration for a variety of concessions and bailouts. And part of that includes an acceleration of rollbacks. Two rollbacks that I think are particularly important to New Mexico are one that was finalized yesterday in the Federal Register, and this was a rollback of Clean Water Act protections. Clean Water Act sets the stage for protection of river and streams across the United States. It's particularly important in an arid state like New Mexico. And the bottom line with the Trump administration's dirty water rule is that it would eliminate protections for upwards of 93% of New Mexico's rivers and waterways, including beloved rivers like the Rio Costilla in my neighborhood up north, and then also potentially the Gila River. And so this leaves a huge void in terms of environmental protection. The other that I'd focus on is the National Environmental Policy Act and longstanding rules that have been in effect since the early 80s, late 70s. And the Council on Environmental Quality, which is charged with implementing the National Environmental Policy Act, is in the process of rolling those back. And one of the catalysts for that rollback was the American Petroleum Institute, who realizes that a lot of the Trump administration's projects have lost in federal court because of NEPA. So now, rather than actually comply with the law, they're seeking to eliminate the rules implementing that law.
So where do you see some of these impacts hitting the ground here in New Mexico?
With the Clean Water Act, I think we're going to witness a pretty immediate impact because federal protections have effectively been lifted. And one of the areas that I think will have a great impact is relative to state water quality protection. So the New Mexico Environment Department will attempt, I think, to fill the void created by the Trump administration's rollback of these Clean Water Act rules. The problem is that the state agencies simply do not have the resources to ensure water quality protection across the state. So I think that rollback of rules essentially gives license to polluters in our rivers and streams. And you could see very, very quickly operations that try to exploit that loophole, in particular because the Clean Water Act, by virtue of this rule, it establishes the jurisdictional reach of what is protected under the Clean Water Act. Now, with 93% of rivers and streams not protected, you would no longer, for example, have to get a Clean Water Act discharge permit in those waters. That's a huge problem, and there is no safety net at this time that the state has put in place.
So this is a really challenging time, given the Trump administration's actions and the impacts this will have on public health and the environment, as well as the COVID-19 public health crisis. I also feel like we're learning a lot about ourselves right now as a society, and what we can accomplish within a given period of time. And I'm wondering if you see opportunities for large scale changes toward better protections of public health and the environment moving forward or even through this crisis.
Yeah, absolutely. I think it's a fascinating time. It is a moment of intense suffering for people, for workers who have lost their jobs, for people whose families are dealing with the coronavirus. There was a massive amount of suffering. At the same time, the coronavirus is provoking a conversation about the role of government. How does government serve the public interest? How do people get involved with their government? What are the relationships between people to people and communities to communities? And I think that is a fascinating conversation. I don't think that there's any such thing as certainty at this point in terms of where we are going, but I do think that fundamental role of fundamental relationship between people and the government is now unsettled. And there are pathways out of that that I think are very positive, especially dealing with looming crises like climate crisis that are similar if slower rolling than the pandemic. So I could see emerging out of this. This will not happen, by the way, by virtue of Trump administration action, but I think that conversation could play itself out in terms of electoral politics and in terms of providing effectively a backbone if there is a political change in Washington, D.C., for very fundamental changes at a federal level. And I do think it'll animate state level action as well. I think the energy industry is a key example of that and the role of, for example, oil and gas in the state. You know, two things are happening. One, we are realizing how dependent we are on oil and gas revenue for state budgets and that we need to diversify away from oil and gas revenue. And we have the climate crisis, which compels us to transition away from fossil fuels. There's a very interesting, a very important, and a very urgent conversation that flows from those two facts.
Okay, so we're seeing this drop in demand, drop in prices. And I was reading this week that most of the tankers are being used right now, not to transport oil necessarily, but to be storing it. And the Western Environmental Law Center has represented clients up in northwestern New Mexico who are fighting drilling in their communities up there. Is drilling still going on even with this drop in demand?
We are witnessing an absolute collapse in new drilling, both in the San Juan Basin, which was frankly not particularly active. I believe there's about one drilling rig prior to the coronavirus outbreak that was operating. And in the Permian Basin, it'll take a little bit more time, but we are also seeing a collapse in drilling there. In fact, where industry is moving is towards a shut-in of oil and gas wells across the state. So for example, just this last Friday, the New Mexico State Land Office held a teleconference hearing to address an emergency shut-in rule to allow oil and gas companies to shut in their oil and gas wells without losing their lease rights. So I think we're going to see a massive ramp down of not just drilling, but existing production in existing fields.
So we know how this hits the state budget, but I'm curious how else this drop in demand can affect New Mexico, will affect New Mexico. And I'm curious if you would talk a little bit about what the difference is between managed decline in the industry and kind of what we're seeing right now.
Yeah, there's two options for federal and state government at this point. And they're premised on the notion that the typical boom bust cycle of oil and gas development is not a cycle that is necessarily operative right now. The International Energy Administration has identified the prospect of peak demand for oil sometime in the mid 2020s. And I think because of the coronavirus outbreak, there's a high likelihood that that point has been accelerated, which means that oil and gas production isn't going to boom and bust. Rather, it's going to start to tilt downwards, which means it's urgent for states to get a handle on what this means. And there are two options. One, a managed decline, which is where the state and federal government work in tandem to diversify revenue streams, protect workers, both in terms of near-term job losses, but also transitioning to new jobs, and then dealing with the legacy of oil and gas infrastructure on the landscape that creates massive amount of pollution, fragments habitat, dirties waterways, dirties the air, and contributes to public health impacts. That's one option. The other option is a chaos decline, where federal and state regulators pretend that we can go back to a point we were at prior to the coronavirus and pretend that the climate crisis doesn't exist. And frankly, states like New Mexico do not have control over global oil markets, and global oil markets will all tip into decline. And if that happens, then that will have even more severe impacts to the state's solvency and ability to provide public services. So from my perspective, there is one option, which is to initiate a conversation in the state with political leadership, with stakeholders, with our federal partners, in particular our delegation, which is very good, and have a conversation about what a managed decline looks like for New Mexico. And to be clear, a decline is kind of a negative word, but this opens up an immense opportunity for New Mexico to diversify its economy, create really stable, high-paying jobs for working families, protect our intertwined natural and cultural heritage. This is why we love and live in New Mexico. So I think that there is an immense opportunity within this conversation, even as it is a very difficult conversation.
Right. Well, Erik, thank you so much for coming on the show this week. I appreciate it.
You're welcome. Thank you, Laura.